Good. We have a long interview marathon here tonight. It's good.
Yeah.
And in the other room, actually, on the other side of the... We're in the studio here. On the other side, there's even more from the band sitting in front of laptops and doing interviews. So, it all began many years ago with, no joke, with the second Lady Gaga album. There's a song called Judas, and there was the first time where I realized how much I liked the word. It was just super, it's just a super strong word, the Judas. It was like, it had a real impact on me, but I didn't think about making a song or a record like that, or the character, whatever, but it kind of stayed with me. I didn't forget about that word. And then I've seen some documentaries on TV, maybe like 2.5 years ago, and it was like a different, let's say, truths about the whole Judas story. We are not religious persons, but if we pretend for a while that this all is historic, then there's different point of views of how these things could have happened. It's not just a simple treason. Maybe Judas is the actual savior, because through all this treason, everything what we know of, like, let's say, Christian mythology happened. And I found it quite interesting. And then I stumbled upon this lost Gospel of Judas, which was forbidden by the Catholic Church, which gives you a little different inside view on the whole thing, and it sheds a different light. And I was reading a little in like sources in the internet, and I was on some kind of vacation at the Baltic Sea, and I was looking at the sea and reading, and I was scribbling with a pencil and a piece of sheet of paper in front of me, and then I was scribbling this symbol here, thinking about this Judas thing, and I realized it's an inverted cross, which at first place everyone considers to be something negative, something bad, and then it's also a J for Judas. So on second view, you see there's something more behind it. And I found it so fascinating that I sent those guys from the band in our WhatsApp chat an audio message and said, "Hey guys, I think we're gonna have to call our next album Judas, and maybe we even find an interesting way to make it a concept album with a topic." So then we started digging and started seeing all these varieties of the character of Judas and how you can interpret things, how you can mirror yourself in this character. And yeah, this was just super inspiring. It's not an album against the church or for the church. It's not religious or anti-religious, but it's inspired by that character of Judas and this huge gray area between those two poles of Judas the savior and Judas a traitor. And that was just super inspiring. Yeah, we did. We also took a step forward musically here, because we had this weird idea of, hey, we have the time now. It's a pandemic. We don't play any summer festivals. We don't play our Iron Maiden tour. We don't play our own tour. Let's just do a double record, and let's do everything for real. If you have a church organ, we record it in a church. If you have a choir, we record people and not just some stupid sample libraries. If you listen to strings, we record real strings, and so on and so on. So this record is like really like not just one, it's like 10 steps forward production wise. We really did like everything we could the old school analog kind of way. If you listen to electronic stuff on that record, then it's electronic stuff, but it's not a choir. You know, electronics stay electronics here. We use keyboards for keyboard sounds, not for strings. Yeah, we're used to work with strings for the Swan Songs project, but I think the only thing here is that the work on the Swan Songs records just made us better in these kind of techniques, you know, artistically, these are different worlds for us. The Swan Songs things for us is more like a band internal side project. The rest of the band had to see me and our guitar player P on a tour in Europe in early 2020. Every night on the nightliner on the tour bus, reading in the Bible and the Gospel of Judas and analysis by Judas about Judas, which we got from a theology professor, which helped us to find like interesting sources about those varieties of the character. So we were like, guys, we're cooking something out here, because our guitar player and me, we were the ones mainly interested in the topic. And then we came up and presented it to the rest of the band, and they found it super interesting. And then what we just did is we went into a songwriting camp. It was re really a songwriting camp of 1 week. It was us plus seven more people, like mainly our live and studio crew, people we worked together. And we started all together writing songs in groups of two or three people. And we changed the people in the groups every day. And we had a list of different kind of, let's say, it's not topics, it's more like feelings about Judas. So you go in different directions, like this song should be, I don't know, angry and about treason. This song should be more like brotherhood and what, blah, 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 you know. So we went in like those different feelings with these different groups and wrote music for 7 days straight. And after that, we had like 30 nice song ideas, and then we just had to reduce them. Yeah, you know, it took a while to give this thing l shape lyrically. After this 1 week of songwriting, it took about 2 or 3 months to finish each single lyric. We came up with a couple of 100% lyrics within the songwriting camp, but most songs, they just had like a chorus with like the main topic and like the main things, always mixed with a lot of gibberish and fantasy language, you know, just phonetic stuff to fill and to give you the idea of the melody. So we really wanted to make this properly. So the second thing we did after camp was we knew 24 songs can't go on one CD. So we took like two CDs and kind of split them, which songs felt a little darker, which felt a little brighter. And we made the actual order of the songs very, very early, which gave us a chance to let the songs go into each other. They kind of, most of them kind of crossfade. So it's more like a movie. It's not song, song, song. You kind of stay in the vibe. And because of that, we had the chance then to finish the lyrics and kind of give it an overall feeling. So you're not like on one moment, like, oh, what's happening here? That doesn't fit the album. So this is how we did it. And a lot of 80s. It's a lot of 80s music on the Salvation. Yeah. That was actually the idea, to give you this movie feeling, like when you're watching like one of these over-length movies like Lord of the Rings or The Hobbit or whatever, you also have this break in the middle, and it always happens at a logical place. It does not happen like within a big fight. So you have the chance to have these two humps where you're going. It's not just one album, you go like, oh, there's the dynamic, and then you're done. You really have the chance to do this two times, which was kind of nice. I think if it wasn't for the CDs, we wouldn't have thought about it. If there was like, I don't know, pl place on a CD for 24 songs without being a grindcore band with 1 minute songs, then we wouldn't have done it, but we were forced to do that. And in the end, I must say, it was kind of beautiful, because we could build up the suspension two times on two different kind of levels. That was nice.
I think for me the biggest challenge was still like to that we had our own rule, only using Fuzz guitar pedals or the Fuzz sound that is just over.
It's like no real metal sound, you
Yeah,
know, like this.
100% distortion and not so many details in the sound, like a metal guitar, like with a Fuzz guitar, is like
You can't
so.
even do this. It
Yeah.
doesn't work with the sound.
For some of us being metalheads, it first felt like limitation.
Because like, oh, I want it.
But then like, okay, cool, let's work on it. And it turned out to be a very characteristic sound that also made the album sound whole, because we were all kind of limited or forced to work with our creativity in a different way.
Yeah, if you have to relearn your instrument, you do different things. I think the most challenging for me was the track, it's the last one on the first album. It's the one which only consists of the choir and my voice. No band, no instruments. I think this was the most challenging because I'm starting the song 100% naked, you know? It's just the voice and you don't even know the harmonies which are coming. It's like just super, super dry. Like in a movie when someone starts singing and there's no soundtrack to it, then it's finally in the back, it's kind of things build up. And this is very challenging as a singer because, you know, the louder the music is, the heavier, the more you have around yourself to mask all your things that don't make you perfect, especially live. Even if you fuck up, you just go like, and it kind of sounds good because you have like double bass somewhere. But that was super challenging because it's just choir and voice and you totally have to nail that feeling. You can't fuck up in detail. I wouldn't know how to do that live unless we had a real choir. I think it will be nice to do that live one day, but it wouldn't work without a choir. You know, this is a double album with many songs that are not to be supposed to play live, and also songs that we wouldn't have put on a normal record. I'm always pissed when I buy an album of a band that I really like, and then I see, oh, it's 10 or 11 songs, and then it's like 3 songs are instrumentals and 2 songs are interludes. Then I'm like, oh. You know, we would never do that, but on a 24 record, you can do that. So not each song is designed to be a live song, and if you try, then you have to find another way. There would be a chance to sing the song with piano and voice instead of choir and voice, but we have to find a different way. I see it that way. If you have, like, let's say the Harry Potter movie, as a movie, you have CGI and all the effects and color correction and blah 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 and months of shooting. If you want to take this thing and put it on a theater stage, you have to do things more rock and roll. You don't have a CGI. If someone is I don't know, flying on a broom, then you have someone to hang up there and fly, you know? So, and that's the same with albums and rock and roll. So you're producing an album for months, or some artists for years and years and years, and it has nothing to do with like what a 5-piece band can do. And then you come up on stage and you have to find a way to rock and roll around it. And I like it. I like it when I see bands and I see their approach, how they try to find a way to make these overproduced songs work on stage. I love it. Yeah, of course not. No.
It's the whole experience that's different.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. I mean, to be fair, we have a computer on stage, but we are not one of these bands who's playing things from the computer which we can do. We don't play guitars from track. We don't play blah, blah, blah. But we play like super electronic sounds from track because we have a keyboarder, but he has only 2 hands. And we have like zero bad conscience about like huge pads and effect sounds and synthetic basses to come from the computer. So it's always us and the little part that also makes us part electro and industrial band beside being a rock or metal band. Or if you're a band which are working with this reduced sound, for instance, you have AC/DC, you know, you have 2 guitars, one left, one right and stuff, or Machine Head are the best example for like a super classic approach to old school metal. You have 2 guitar players, one of them is singing, and if one of them plays a solo, you have this, you listen to that solo on that one side in the stereo panorama. That's like the classic Machine Head album. There's no like 1,000 overdubs and whatever, except for some backing vocals. So this is the other approach. This is not ours, but it also works. So this is why if you go to a Machine Head concert, you get the album experience, and it's a super immensely good band which can pull it off. They sound the same like on stage as on an album, 100% live. It's brilliant.
Or the old Pantera, Even Records,
Yes.
where there was
Yeah.
just bass playing and the guitar solo.
Yeah,
And the same thing live. But it's cool. I mean, it gives 100% rock and roll feel.
Yes, of course, we were already discussing about different kind of backdrops and light installments and whatever, but the thing is, everything at the moment is so vague, it's so unplannable that we're not in a rush. So far it's not, it's just not possible. Yeah, we have the first show confirmed now. It's a festival in Ukraine, end of July, but that's a festival. Oh, we have to have a new backdrop. We need to order a new backdrop since then. Fuck, I need to write that down. We need to order a new backdrop. But that's actually it. So yes, there will be something, but we haven't come up with something real yet because it's no sense in doing that.
Right.
But I'm gonna send myself now this backdrop email.
Right.
Thanks for putting that out.
Yeah.
So if you see on social media, if you see us playing on that stage, on that festival in Ukraine, if you see pictures, then you can be sure you're the one why we have a backdrop there.
Yeah.
Not exactly. Not like not a video in the woods and stuff. These videos are somehow connected, and some say the priest was before, for they know not what they do. Others say it's after that. If you look closely, you see that one video begins where the other ends. So they kind of connected in a weird Inception kind of way. But we will be using same symbols in the next videos. We're playing with that that cross on our foreheads all the time, and we're gonna have the same actress in some more videos because we wanted to have like this symbol, this allegory in like more music videos, so a person you can get used to, like in your favorite movies. We're always trying to do like the cinematic approach, even for the music videos. So you're not like having to get used to different persons in each music video. It's more like, oh, there we are again with Lord of Lost. That's the Judas world because it's the same girl in the video, you know. So we kind of go on with that, not for every video, and we're not gonna go back in the woods, but we are trying to stay in the same artificial world, let's say like that. Yeah, we did one thing after we finished writing the music for the track Viva Vendetta, which is on the second CD. We took the instrumental and sent the instrumental to different friends of other bands without telling them our lyrics, without even telling them the name of the song, and we didn't for sure tell them about the concept of Judas. We kept that as a secret for everyone. And we told them, pretend like this is your song, like someone of your band has written the song and now asking you as a singer to write lyrics on it and your own vocal melodies. Treat the song like you treat your own songs and come up with your very own idea. And everyone did. We asked, like, I don't know, 35, 36 people, and I was expecting to say, to have five people saying yes. Like every time you ask for a remix, and they go all like, ignore the mails. And then some go like, yeah, okay, how much money? And in this case, like everyone answered. And then in the end, like we received like 32 versions of like 35 people we asked. So I had to went go to the label and say like, can we do a double bonus CD? And they were like, fucking hell, we can. That sounds awesome. And you listen to these tracks, it's the same instrumental all the time. Okay, sometimes they added also some music it to it. So you have like, I don't know, a medieval rock band adding bagpipes and stuff, you know, and some others electronic elements, but you have their own story and the whole genre flips all the time. So, but it stays the same, but it appears to you very differently. Like who's the one who's singing kind of brings the genre into like different directions. It's a super interesting experiment which we wanted to do for years, and now we did it. Yeah, and apart from that, it's just a great opportunity for cross promotion, you know. Like you can you can tell something about all your colleagues from other bands every day, and you're having a reason for it. You don't have to do this these shout-outs all the time. Hey, they have a new album. Maybe you want to listen to it. Hey, you have something really interesting actually to tell. And it's so nice to have so many people connected, because most of the musicians are friends of other bands, which we are connected to anyway. I remember playing our last show in Belgium. We couldn't play the last one because I was getting sick one day before in London, or 2 days before, so we had to cut off the tour. But before, a couple of years before that, we played in Belgium, and the funny thing about that is we slept in France.
Right.
We played in Belgium, but the hotel was in France. And then we went back to Germany.
And the driver was driving me 30 minutes into the next city because I asked him where I can get Belgium chocolate as a gift. And I did not know that we have to drive like forever to the next city.
In the middle of the night.
Yeah. And it was not too far from the show or something. And it was like, where have you been? I said, I just wanted to have some chocolate. He said, oh, let's go there. But I got my chocolate. It was amazing.
So that's the first thing I have in mind when I think about Belgium. Yeah. Playing in Belgium, sleeping in France, going back to Germany.
Yeah. And amazing chocolate.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your interview. It was very nice.
And see you next time. Or on tour. You never know.
Yes.
Cross fingers.